Hay House presents The Sacred Andean Codes by Marcela Lobos. Read by Nancy Crane. This audiobook includes a supplemental PDF that contains images as well as the acknowledgments and about the author sections from the print edition. I will be referring to the PDF throughout the recording, so be sure to have it handy as you listen. It should be among the files you downloaded when you purchased this audiobook. Foreword by Alberto Villoldo, Ph.D. Mystical origin stories are envisioned as multidimensional spirals rather than linear tales, especially when referencing new rites of passage. Paradoxically, I feel drawn to begin this foreword with a chronological description of how I first encountered the destiny-altering initiations known as the Munai Ki. May these words help you form a clear map for your journey with the rites. In the early 1970s, I received a research grant to study the medicinal plants and healing practices of the Amazonian shamans. At the time, although I was fresh out of graduate school, I was directing a small research laboratory at San Francisco State University, studying if we could create not only psychosomatic disease, but also health. I was guided to this work by my professor, Dr. Stanley Krippner, with whom I had co-authored a book, The Realms of Healing. Dr. Krippner encouraged me to learn about the psychedelic plants that allow the shamans to glimpse the invisible world and about the powerful shrubs and barks that regenerate the body and the brain. While working with the shamans in the rainforest, I heard about the ancient mystery schools that had once thrived in the Andes and were destroyed by the Inquisition. I thought this was the stuff of legend, until a renowned shaman from the city of Pucallpa, the last navigable port of the Amazon, said to me, "We can speak with the plants, and they heal and teach us, but the Andes is where the master shamans are." I was intrigued. And then, in early 1972, during an ayahuasca ceremony in the Amazon, I had a vision of what appeared to be a city of gold. Ah, I thought, the legendary El Dorado that so many explorers had searched for. A week later, I boarded a flight to Lima, the capital of Peru, and then embarked on a 7-day bus ride to Cusco, the seat of the ancient Inca Empire, to see if I could meet one of these master shamans and find anyone who knew of the City of Gold. In Cusco, later that fall, I learned that Machu Picchu was known as the City of Light. In this visit, I met and befriended Dr. Manuel Chavez Bayon, then chief archaeologist in Machu Picchu. He spoke to me about a city known as Choqquequirau, the City of Gold, that few had explored. We promptly set about planning an expedition to the archaeological site. My sponsors from the United States were happy to fund this adventure, but Peru at the time was overrun by Maoist guerrillas, and we were never able to make it. Marcela would be the one to explore the fabled City of Gold in 2009, and then hike beyond it to Vilcabamba, the sacred place, and then go on to Espiritu Pampa, the place of the spirits. These were the four sacred cities of the Inca, each one farther from the physical world of people and closer to the invisible spirit world. To this date, very few people have explored the four fabled secret cities of the Inca. I'm convinced that these are the real El Dorado, not walls covered in gold, but the real treasure of the Inca, the secret knowledge. During my first visit to Cusco, Dr. Chavez Bayon told me about an expedition he had led to the Quero communities, the last descendants of the Inca. The Quero had remained invisible to the West for 500 years, living in villages above 15,000 feet where the Spanish conquerors never found them. They spoke a perfect Quechua and maintained their ancient customs. The members of that original expedition to the Quero included the archaeologist Oscar Núñez del Prado, whose son Juan would later become a prominent teacher of the Andean traditions and a personal friend. In the early 1970s, Dr. Chavez Bayon's home in Cusco was a buzzing mecca of indigenous students from the University of Cusco. They were helping him paint murals reproducing the ceremonial art of the Inca. He had a passion for the iconography of the ancient peoples of the Andes, the imagery found in the weavings and ceramics. Local farmers would bring in pottery they had uncovered while tilling the soil, as they knew they would receive a meal and a reward from the good doctor, who would copy the art and then turn over the valued ceramics to the archaeological museum. Dr. Chavez Bayon would be my academic mentor for the next 3 decades until his death. At his home, I would meet the first Quero villagers. I remember my initial contact with the Quero and how it made me most uncomfortable. Whereas Andean Indians looked down at the ground when you spoke with them, a submissive gesture taught to their ancestors by the conquistadors, who insisted that anyone of European descent be addressed as Wiracocha, or God. The Quero looked you in the eyes, unflinching. They seemed to gaze into your soul to discover who you were inside. At Dr. Chavez Bayon's studio, the Quero would wear their colorful red ponchos woven with the royal seal of the Inca. They were the only Andeans permitted to have the royal emblem in their attire. Yet when they left the studio, they would don vanilla-colored ponchos with no markings on them. Otherwise, people would stone them, for the church had spread rumors that these men and women were witches. On one occasion, I saw a mother run up to the Pacos with her baby in her arms, asking them to bless her child. It was not until 1982, with my friend Americo Yabar, that I met the high Pacos, or most respected shamans. Americo's family had been the heirs to a Spanish land grant that included the Quero villages. At the once grand family hacienda known as Muyumarca, I met Don Manuel Quispe. He was the eldest Alto Masayuk, or wisdom keeper, and the one who would initiate me into the lineage of Andean sages. Don Manuel accompanied me on numerous expeditions through the Andes. One day in the spring of 1995, he asked me to invite my top students to join the shamans on a pilgrimage to Mount Ausangate. The following year, 20 of my students and I hiked and rode horses to our base camp by the Blue Lagoon. We had come prepared to host and feed 5 or 10 Pacos. The following day, Don Manuel appeared with nearly 100 Quero men, women, and children who had walked for 3 days from their mountain villages to join us. We were to help them bring in a new carpai, the mosok, or new rite. As is often the case with shamans, you don't grasp the entirety of your task until you are in the midst of it. It seemed odd at first that a group of Andean shamans and a band of Western mystics would come together to summon the lightning from the upper world and bring down a new initiation rite that could benefit all humanity. I thanked Don Manuel for inviting us, feeling honored that he recognized our readiness for this task. "I invited you because we needed someone to represent the conquistador, the white man," he explained. "Our people need to heal the wound of the conquest, the raping of our mothers and kidnapping of our children. We need to bury the sword of the conquest." He paused and looked me in the eyes, and I could see a tear running down his cheek. "This rite is also for your people," he went on. "You and I are bringing it forth to the world, but neither of us is special. We are simply an instrument of our times." In that extraordinary expedition that we were fortunate enough to film, the Munai Ki was born, and I acquired my Andean nickname, Chakaruna, the man bridge. I would become a bridge for an ancient wisdom to a modern time, and the Munai Ki would be the instrument. You can watch this documentary at www.munai-ki.org. Receiving the Munai Ki rites. Don Manuel shared all the carpais, or initiations, with me, confiding that I was the first non-Indian he had ever brought into his spiritual tradition. "The carpais are seeds that offer you gifts of power," he explained. "They are like the corn. If you plant the kernels deep inside your heart and water them with your love, Munai. They will grow and produce great big ears of corn, but you must use this power for good. As I received Don Manuel's carpies, I noticed how issues I had struggled with for years were starting to resolve. My love and empathy for others were growing. With the more advanced initiations, I began to understand how I could make the world do my bidding and what a high price one had to pay for imposing one's will on life. I learned how the advanced rites joined you to a lineage of healers and shamans who had defeated death and time and who were available to help you fulfill your mission.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.